Welcome, 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 geeks and nerds, girls and boys, to another all-new edition of Geek to Me Radio. We are broadcasting at you live from GalaxyCon Richmond. We've got a cavalcade of guests lined up from Star Trek. We've got John de Lancie, Batman the Animated Series. We have Diane Pershing and John Glover. And we've got the co-creators of Blue Devil, Paris Cullins, and Gary Kohn. All that and more. Stand by.
We're talking TV, comics and movies, and video games. And if you don't know, Star Trek from Star Wars, we'll try to explain. There are 12 doctors, 4 Hogwarts houses, 1 ring rules and more. To be the greatest Pokemon master, you must catch them all. You must catch them all. Try to catch them all. Gotta catch them all. Gotta catch them all.
And if you're driving around the greater St. Louis area right now, hearing this on 105.3 FM and 1380 AM, thank you very much for tuning in. If you're hearing this out there in the world, you're streaming us, you might be right here in Richmond listening. Thank you very much for finding us. And of course, if you're hearing us after the fact in the podcast form on Google Play, SoundCloud, iTunes, Podomatic, we appreciate your subscribing there. Make sure you leave us a nice 5-star rating and a comment. We'd love to hear what you think about the show. With that, we're going to jump right in because it is a jam-packed show today. We're going to kick it off with the creators of Blue Devil.
Talking now with Gary Kohn and Paris Cullins, talking about you originally worked on Blue Devil, and you've got the new Devil, which is out right now, coming soon.
Coming in March. First issue will be out in March from Red Anvil Press.
And it's like you just talked about, for those of you who are listening right now, we talked before we started recording this, bringing the fun back again.
That's right, bringing the fun back again. That what we really loved about the Blue Devil was that it was chaos and anything mattered. So it was both space, like our newsletter. It was called Circus and Sorcery, and it was about both sides. It's about anything happening, and that most of it fun, and most of it just as funny as it was serious. And then it just all went out the window.
The word that always comes up when we talk about Blue Devil is bounce.
That's right.
It was a bouncing, highly kinetic comic. And that stopped when Paris stopped being the artist. And it starts again here.
Yeah, I'll take a picture of this. So if those of you who are listening, if you want to go to my Facebook page, it's facebook.com/geektomeradio. We'll take a picture of this up there.
Right. And so from both ends that Gary Kohn's been working, he's bringing back a demon gun, and we've been, what's the word for it, from all kinds of corners, people have been asking us to write the strangest things for them. So we're doing a thing called Alter Ego, which is a personal little project that is coming up, and that's been, I don't know what you call it, a personal joy.
Okay. Right?
It's comics in the way I really like them, but not old. That's the part that I'm really finding myself enjoy about. I mean, there was a comic book convention in Newark, and a kid that was like 12 years old walked up to me and just started talking about Ted Kord and how much he liked it better than the other one. He just thought he was fun.
Yeah.
Well, the other one was, he just, well, it's just too serious, and who says that science even works? I don't care.
What Paris and I always did was put energy into books and kept them kinetic and given momentum. And what I see in a lot of new comics is that they are bog slow. And I think that probably is something carried over from anime at first. But they move at a snail pace. And comics, that's fine for some comics. But there's a market for comics that move.
Yeah. The comic you read is the comic you should enjoy. Not the investment of 20 comic books down the line. But the thing that I was really talking about is that this perfect storm that I was saying is, there it is, DC's taking another shot at it, as they always do, but this one has this weird connotation or this weird thing to it, and there it is, they're putting out DC Streaming, and they're putting out,
Swamp Thing,
and in Swamp Thing, is Cassidy. That's right, Mr. Cassidy. And from
Anna
that, Ziering. That's right, and Anna Ziering, Mr. Sharknado.
Yeah.
If anybody's going to be the new devil, it's Mr.
Facebook,
Sharknado.
Buddy, he invited me to come down to wherever they're shooting in North Carolina.
That's right.
To see the set, but then they reduced it from 13 episodes to 10 episodes, so the set closed up. But if they do a second one, a second season, we're going to go down and hang out.
And that's the great thing with DC streaming services. They're tapping into those, the Netflix original series and Hulu and everything. These original series are great, so it is a good time.
Yeah.
And if they're bringing back someone like Blue Devil, that's the perfect place to launch it, would be on their streaming service.
Yeah.
This is true. And is he showed up. This whole idea about the way it should look or the way it should be showed up. This is about to go to print, so it's all coming out the second season. The book, all happening, being told about it this year, coming out next year. You know, along with that, a plethora of all ideas that are both energetic, adventurous, and fun. A strange thing happened, and that's the way I see it. That's what a guy served out of nowhere, and he wanted me to do him a cow comic book, a cow calendar, but a cartoon one. Yeah.
Well,
yeah, and it's called Bodacious Bovine, so it's about a slightly sexy cow story, but really still a cow, just some weird relationship between the farmer and the cow and his jealous wife.
So now that you said it, I think all cows are slightly sexy, aren't they? I mean,
see what I'm saying? People are admitting. People are coming to grips with things that they don't want to know. They don't want to admit. But what's also happened is what? This is the third horned character that I've got to deal with. Just like and what? It's the second blue character. So I refuse to make this one blue.
Right.
But we got another blue one that's coming up right behind it. So it's this trifecta. That's happening. That's all I can say. And once again, we're forcing him by blackmail to write the cow story.
Yeah,
but he keeps trying to run. Like he's
show
trying to
me the money.
That's right. He goes, I want to get out.
So, with Blue Devil being brought back, that's got to be kind of a very cool thing to you guys. With the DC streaming service, is one of those hopes that. Wouldn't it be nice if one of our characters get up there on the big screen or something? That's got to be your dream.
If Blue Devil spins off into a TV show, God, we're talking about real money, like hundreds of dollars.
Right.
Right in our pockets, man.
Right.
Hundreds.
You'll see that little check show up for at least a couple nickels from the residuals.
Yeah, it'd be great.
But I mean, in addition to the money, it's obviously rewarding to see one of your creations still beloved. Because I know Blue Devil came out at the same time as Booster Gold,
yep.
The Blue Beetle run, Giffen and DeMatteis on Justice League. Yeah. So that was, that's that 80s nostalgia. People are crazy for it. So that's got to be a good time
to
be reflecting back.
Yeah, it is. They want that back because they want something that's not indicative to just being wrong. They don't want to argue over was it the wrong thing to do. It's too compromised.
It seems to me that was probably the last good time to work for DC.
Yeah.
If you wanted to do something original and interesting.
Yeah.
I mean, if you just wanted to do their characters over and over again in the million ways you can do it.
One has
then
to
I get it, but I sure didn't want to do that.
Yeah.
So there was that window of opportunity from 1980 to Crisis.
And
Crisis changes it all.
Right.
But that's where we were. We were in that window of opportunity.
The perfect storm again.
Yeah.
And I have to say that the biggest contributor to that change is Karen Berger and the publisher and the leader of DC Comics, Jeanette Kahn.
And Dick Giordano.
Dick Giordano. We're going to say it one more time. But they just didn't want to stick to. They like continuity, but they wanted to bring something new. And you're talking about Camelot 3000. That's right.
Joe Orlando.
Oh my God! You know, he was
to
a godsend.
To be able to work under the guidance of Joe Orlando, Dick Giordano, and Len Wein was incredible.
Yeah.
It was just terrific.
It's very sad when Len Wein passed. It's one of those comic deaths that really kind of it hurts.
No,
I cried.
That's it.
I haven't seen Len in 25 years.
Friend, brother.
Absolutely.
Uncle, you want to name it? Like I said, I was constantly having problems at being late, and I say the most contrived things, and he just walked over and said, Paris, there's not a lie I haven't told. There isn't a truth I haven't bent, and there isn't an excuse I haven't taken. So, with me, you can trust just come in and tell me, because it doesn't even matter. Tell me the lie you want, but just bring me the broken work, and we'll make everything better. You know, just come in. And that meant everything to me.
So for people who want to get more of the New Devil and Demon Gun, where can they find those? How are they available?
There are 60 copies of Demon Gun. Actually, I'm probably down to 45 at this point. You can have one if you want.
Okay.
And it's my baby. I own it. And I'm just going to keep printing them as long as I can. As for a New Devil, that's going to come up. We're looking for March from Red Anvil Comics.
Red Anvil.
And that should be...
We want all of the books done before we put out...
They have Diamond distribution. We're looking for 4-issue miniseries and then a trade paperback. And that will complete the first arc. And if it sells, then we'll look at a second arc. And here it is. First issue.
Oh, nice.
This is New Devil in the Sky Cops.
Yep.
And they're anticipating big trouble in a transformed Manhattan.
Wow.
There's the Statue of Iniquity.
I'll take a picture of this, folks. Again, for those of you listening, it's up on my Facebook page, facebook.com/geeksmeradio.
And down in Central Park, the forces of nice are fighting the forces of not nice.
And I'm going to say that one of the things I thought was really weird, I don't look at it like it's a weird pattern on the back. I don't. George Perez is leaving. George Perez is leaving. And that is a force that comics are never going to get back again. The whole point of my joining comics was Jack Kirby and George Perez. Someone has described my work as Jack Kirby, George Perez, had a baby, had an anime baby, and it was me.
Had an anime baby.
That's crazy. And that's what's missing. When he left, I describe what is that thing called, Infinity Wars, as Jim Starlin, but I describe Endgame as George Perez.
That's good.
And it's that feelings is what's missing. It's just, you know, that's right. It is. And we're going to feel it like a month. It's the perfect storm. And here
Thank you
come
for not finishing
court.
That. It will be on radio. My producer will be hitting the button back home.
First page, first issue, that's the opening caption.
6 months later.
Right. Second issue will be 6 months earlier.
But
first issue is nothing but action for 28 pages.
Nice. And for people who want to follow the two of you, where can they find you online, Twitter, Instagram? Where are you both?
Facebook and wordslingergc@gmail.com.
And the book and the website that we're finishing up with Mike, what's his name? I'm so sorry. Mike.
Ask Mike what his last name is.
Is it Mike Dow?
Yeah,
Mike Dow, but no, we're talking about the guy building our website.
Oh,
the
Mike
New
Fonseca.
Devil.
Mike Fonseca.
Right, Mike Fonseca creating the New Devil. Is that what it's called?
Page.
Right, the New Devil .com.
NewDevil.com.
That's it. And I have Paris Cullins .pro. There you go.
All right.
He's going, third studio, but see this guy is our third.
This is the trifecta.
That's right.
Perfect.
And he's a... He's an in-town specialist, farmer, agriculturist, whatnot. Come in there and say it just for a moment. You come in and I'm going to throw you back out. But say it for a second so he can have it and he can keep it and cut it as he will. You know?
So,
Mike Dow.
Mike and with Utterly Ridiculous Productions.
That's right.
I got Gary and Paris. He's going to be working with me to do the Bodacious Bovines and various characters that are... It's kind of funny. It's
absolutely funny. It's insane.
Yeah.
You know, it's ludicrous.
Yeah.
It's
there should be more to come.
That's right.
The picture says it all.
That's right.
Thank you very much for your time, Paris Cullins. Gary Kohn, thank you very much. Appreciate it.
There they are, live from GalaxyCon Richmond. We're going to take our first break. We're going to come back talking with the voice of Poison Ivy from Batman the Animated Series. Diane Pershing will join us next. Stand by.
All the world is waiting for you and the power you possess.
Hi, I'm John Wesley Shipp, and you're listening to Geek to Me Radio.
John Wesley Shipp, one of the many guests here at GalaxyCon Richmond, as we broadcast live from the show floor. This segment And honestly, this show brought to you by Historic St. Charles. Check out the website, discoverstcharles.com, for an historically good time, as they like to say. Just celebrated their big 250th anniversary with a huge blowout. Historical reenactments taking place, little vignettes from their 250 years of history. A lot to see and do in St. Charles. If you're a foodie, there's a lot of places to eat with great homemade dishes. If you're a history buff, they got you covered there. There's something to see on every corner. There's always something to do. St. Charles is just always buzzing. There's always something going on. If you're maybe listening to this and you're in the Richmond area right now where I am, check out the website, Discover ST Charles. That's discoverstcharles.com. Look up the bed and breakfasts if you want to have a nice, relaxing stay. Maybe you need your amenities. You need your Wi-Fi. That's all right. They have world-class accommodations at the hotel and the convention center. It's nothing that you've possibly experienced before could compare. It's great. If you're in the St. Louis area, hopefully you're enjoying Frontier Park, running around outside, taking your dog for a walk, taking your cat for a walk, your cat's up to that, doing some frisbee golf. I know Joey mentioned he's going to be doing a little outdoor activity. He might be going to St. Charles. I don't know. But if you're listening to this right now, plan your trip. See all the cool things there are to see and do. DiscoverstCharles.com is that website. We are going to go right to our next guest. You'll recognize her voice immediately, I'm sure. Diane Pershing.
We are here talking with Diane Pershing. How are you?
I am so good. Thank you.
Good. I'm glad we finally got the chance to meet. I've obviously grew up watching Batman the Animated Series and all the way back to He-Man and She-Ra.
Woo!
You've been doing voiceover work for quite a while.
40 years.
Does it get easier when you get the more you do it now, especially with technology, or was it better in the older days?
Well, easier. I'm more of a pro than I was when I was starting out, but I guess I've been that for a while. With technology, you know, I don't know that I've noticed the difference. It's sort of the engineer's problem, not mine.
Sure.
I do the work. However they record it is great with me, you know? Yeah.
When you go into developing a character, obviously you've had characters you've done originally that no one else has done. Doing Poison Ivy, which is an established DC Comics character, it's been around. When you were doing that, I know we've talked to Kevin and Lauren about they never read a Batman comic before. What was your experience starting out with Poison Ivy? Did you have any... What did they give you to research the character? How did you find that voice?
Oh, I'm going to shatter all illusions now. No, I never read any Batman. I was told to audition for this particular character for this show, and I went in. I looked at the picture of her, and I noticed that she was, first of all, very sexy, and I had a cosmetic voice that I used all the time when I was selling perfume and lingerie on camera. You know, I mean, not on camera, but a voiceover. Yeah. And then she was also a PhD. So there's a way that you clip that very sexy thing and just give that slight kind of feeling of a real brain at work. See, like that? And I thought, yeah, I can do this. I did it, and I got it. Did I research the character? Not at all. But you know why? Because it was all in the script. The writers were so good. And I got right away that, yes, she's a monster, but she really believes in what she's doing because she really believes she's saving plant life. So it isn't like she's just evil. She has a purpose and a drive. And so, you know, that's one of those villains you love to hate. Yeah.
And I don't know who said it, but someone said a villain never thinks they're the villain. They
never
think they're the... So that, did you approach it from that same standpoint?
Absolutely. You must believe totally that the way you are is the way you need to be. That's it. And there's really very little moral compass there.
And I know Kevin mentioned before that when people say, how do I get into voice acting, Kevin recommends you become an actor. You have to, and I can just tell by the way you're carrying yourself, you are that the actor, and the voice acting then is almost
exactly
secondary nature when you're an actor.
Absolutely. I'm theater trained, as almost the entire cast was. We're theater trained. We love words. We take classes. We've starved for our art, et cetera, and so forth. I fell into voiceovers accidentally just because someone heard me talk and said, have you ever thought of doing voiceovers? I mean, it was that simple, you know. And I love it. And I've really made my career pretty much with a lot of theater in between. I've done voiceovers, you know, and I love it.
And as an actor, too, it's hard to not go back to the theater. I know some people do it, but there's even people who are like super successful will still love going on stage. You can't beat that.
A lot of people do. Lauren Lester, who plays Robin, has just gotten a 1-year on the road tour with a very successful Broadway show. He's in heaven to be going back to theater.
Yeah.
I think that light died in me a while ago. I'm also a little older. You know, I'm much happier doing what I'm doing right now. I've done theater. I will maybe run back and do a quick something, but it doesn't drive me the way it did. Yeah.
And we've had Andrea Romano on the show before, and she always gushes about all of her, you're like her children, she says, all the characters,
right.
And it always makes her a little protective when she sees the characters being used in other media.
Yes.
What was your experience like working with Andrea?
Andrea is the most gifted voice director I've ever worked with, and I have worked with everyone. And I'm not putting anyone down because there's a lot of really gifted. She used to be an actor, and she approaches it that way. A lot of them want, you know, higher, lower, faster, warmer. She would basically talk about character and motivation. Very short sentences, nothing elaborate. But she was so helpful. And also she gave us permission to try things. And that was very important. I loved her. I still love her.
Do you have a favorite story from Batman Animated Series, being in the booth, anything that's that really is like your gem moment of the run?
Being in the booth?
Yeah, working on the cast and the voice and everything.
Well,
like that.
Only that I had Ephraim Zimbalist Jr. on my left and Mark Hamill on my right. And excuse me, that's called heaven.
Right.
Right? I mean, really, amazing, amazing people. That cast was astonishing.
And you continue to do voice work. What's the new project? Do you have anything else coming up that we can keep our ear open for you on?
No, at the moment I just audition and I do a quick, you know, line here and there in a commercial. That's pretty much it. The truth is I'm slowing down. That's why I love doing these cons, because I feel so alive during them. And I love to meet the fans. I just love it. They're just darling, wonderful people.
We just had a fan come up and talk to you and tell you that's got to be such a great feeling to know these characters you've given voice to resonate with so many people.
I had no idea until about 2.5 years ago when someone said, "Are you aware that you have a fan base?" And I said, "No." And the world opened up. Amazing.
And now you're doing these cons like here at GalaxyCon in Richmond.
There we are. Yeah.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Well, it's been an absolute pleasure to talk to you, Diane. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you so much for asking me. What a pleasure.
Thanks.
She is an absolute delight. If you ever get the chance to meet Diane Pershing, maybe if you're driving around the Richmond Newport News area here, come on down. GalaxyCon is going all day today and all day tomorrow. Go to the website. It's galaxycon.richmond, I believe, .org. But just Google GalaxyCon Richmond. It'll come right up. Get your tickets. Come on down. Meet the cast of Batman Animated Series, Star Trek people. We're going to be talking next with the voice of the Riddler, John Glover, right after this commercial break. So stand by.
Hi, this is Barry Bostwick, and damn it, Janet, would you just keep listening and come back to Geek to Me Radio, will you?
I've one thing to say, and that's damn it, Janet, I love you.
We are back. Once again, a guest you can meet here, Barry Bostwick from Rocky Horror Picture Show, along with Patricia Quinn. They're both here. They'll be doing they'll be hosting the live Shadowcast Rocky Horror tonight at 10 o'clock here at the Convention Center in downtown Richmond. So if you get the chance to come on down for that, I'm sure that'll be well worth the trip. This segment brought to you by Marcus Theaters. MarcusTheaters.com is the website. If you want to get out and see the new superhero movie Brightburn, if you have not yet had the chance to check out Avengers Endgame, go out and see it in a Marcus Theater. Let's push them over that hump to beat Avatar. Lots of good movies out right now, and they're only getting better as we get into summer blockbuster season. What better place to see it than in a Marcus Theaters? Locations in 11 different states. Not out here in Virginia, unfortunately, yet, but who knows? That could change. But there are 11 states where you can catch a Marcus Theaters, and it's the best way to see a movie theater. Great concessions, great restaurants, great little bars. You can make a night of going to the theater. It's really a destination event, especially like Ronnie's that they're in St. Louis, or the Chesterfield Marcus. It's not a bad time. Fantastic visuals, the big comfy heated seats. If you're going to see a movie, you might as well do it in first class. Be comfortable while you're doing it. Marcus Theaters.com is that website. Another voice from Batman the Animated Series, and a guest we've had on before, John Glover. We got a chance to sit down and catch up with him.
We're here at GalaxyCon Richmond, joined by a guest who's been on my show a little bit earlier this year, Mr. John Glover. How are you?
I'm swell. How are you?
I'm well, thank you.
Oh, good. Oh, good.
I'm sorry I missed your play in New York. How'd it go?
It was great. We did got nice reviews, real nice reviews, and we accomplished what we set out to do, was to tell a story about an atrocity that happened at a certain period of time in Germany back in the early 40s. And it kind of parallels some stuff that's happening now in the world. So it was very interesting.
And it's got to be great as an actor going back and doing theater.
I'm sure it's like
a first love for an actor. Diane was mentioning the same thing.
Yeah, live theater is nothing like it. It's, you know, it's telling a story live with no net
right
out there on your own. Yeah, it's exciting, very exciting.
What was the rehearsal process? Because you're all seasoned pros. How ahead of time do you get the script? Do you go in and just do blocking for a show like this in New York? How does the process work?
Well, we'd had the script for a while. Some of us had it longer than others. Mm-hmm. And we spent a week doing what they call table reads. So we sit around a big table and read the play and read it again and read it and kind of give it a sort of an emotional structure, I guess. And then we get up and get on its feet. I mean, that's how many directors rehearse. This director, Ethan McSweeney, when we first started to get up, he said, let's just read the play on our feet and move where you want to move and just walk around and see what happens. So we did the play. It sort of blocked itself. I mean, nobody said, well, I should go here, there. And, you know, everybody just went where they wanted. I never had an experience like that. It was very interesting.
Very organic, just kind of natural.
Sure, yeah. And then we went back and worked on scenes and gave them a structure, a more definite structure. But it was, but every director works on his own.
Yeah.
You know, there's no set way to do it.
And another great hit you've had this year, Shazam.
Shazam,
we didn't get a chance to talk about that when last we were on the air, but that did really well.
It did, didn't it? Yes, I was quite happy. And I went to see it, and it was very good.
That's so now, I think, if I'm not mistaken, there was a scene in Smallville too that's two of your children have thrown you out windows now. What's that about?
Yes, well, I guess I have a certain aura about me that is unmistakable to raise horrible children, male children.
And I know you've recently been very active on Twitter about you're wanting to do a Marvel movie now. I'm not sure if it was you we put out or someone else suggested Mr. Sinister would be a great character now that the X-Men are back in the Marvel fold. Is this something like that kind of was suggested to you, or is it something you kind of brainstormed about the character?
No, I didn't. It sounds very interesting, though.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you would, I mean, obviously...
I love to work.
One you haven't done, though, is Marvel. You've done a lot of DC now.
Well, I'd like to, you know, be ambidextrous, as they say, with my DCs and Marvels.
Playing both sides of the pond. Well,
that would be nice. I mean, it's not a war. They're allies, right?
Everyone should be.
They feed off each other, I would think.
The success of one helps the other.
Yes.
The rising tide lift all boats. I think that's the way the expression goes.
High diddly-dee in actor's life for me.
And you're doing here your GalaxyCon Richmond.
Yes,
you've got another con coming up soon as well, yeah?
Yeah, Indianapolis. And then one I'm really excited about, because I grew up there, is the Shore Leave in the Baltimore area.
Yeah.
I grew up in Maryland, in Salisbury, on the Eastern Shore, and went to school at Towson, which is now Towson University. It was Towson State Teachers College when I went there. So I'll get to see some old friends, perhaps, that I went to school with.
And when you go, do you come in like you stayed a week? Do you, obviously, a place like Baltimore you're familiar with, or you just, is it a quick in and out for the con? Because obviously you're busy, and I think you're West Coast oriented, aren't you?
I'm ambidextrous there, too.
Bicoastal.
Yes, all right. Yeah. No, I don't know. It's different all the time. I have relatives around here I'd like to go see when it finishes. So I don't know. I play it as it lays.
That's the best way to take it, I think.
Yeah.
Well, I want to take up more of your time. You've got more people, but it's always a pleasure to talk to you, John Glover.
Thanks
so much for your time.
Thank you, James.
Thank you.
All right.
very, very good guy, John Glover. And again, he's here all weekend too. You can get here with Kevin Conroy. You can do a Batman animated series photo op, which I'm actually on my way to do here after I get done with the broadcast. So check it out. GalaxyCon.com is the website. You can follow him on Twitter at RealJohnGlover. We're going to take our last break, come back and wrap things up, talking to John de Lancie right after this. Stand by.
Somewhere some villain schemes, but his number's up.
3, 2, 1.
Darkwing
Duck. When there's trouble, you call me.
Hi, this is Brent Spiner. You're listening to Geek to Me Radio.
We are back. Brent Spiner, another one of the guests who are here, along with Michael Dorn, who played Lieutenant Worf. And of all the Star Trek guests, another one who is here, we got to speak with the incredible John de Lancie.
We're talking now with the omnipotent, omnipresent, omniscient John de Lancie. How are you, sir?
I'm very well, thank you.
So it's got to be an amazing feeling for you to do these characters that are larger than life. You have people who go to these conventions who love to come up and talk to you. What's the best reaction, or what's the most surprising thing that you get out of doing the conventions?
Well, I'm going to change the question a little bit to tell you what I get from them, which is so nice and which I never thought would be the case. And that is that people come up to me and they say, I want you to meet my father, and I want you to meet my daughter. My father was the one who turned me on to Star Trek, and that was something that he and I shared, and and it was really meaningful to us, to me, because I didn't get to see him very much, and this was something that we made a date every week to share with each other. And then I've done the same thing with my daughter here. And it's not often that, as an actor, one gets to perform and to be in a show that's meaningful enough so that you have grandfather, father, granddaughter there.
Yeah.
And Star Trek is one of them, one of the few.
And I guess a similar vein, my grandmother, my grandfather died when I was young. My grandmother moved in with us, and she had to watch her story. So I first saw you as the half of Eugene and Calliope on
That's
Days of
right.
Our Lives.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is another great character. That show's still going on.
Yeah.
When you look back over your body of work, you must be just, it's got to take you aback a little bit to think of all the fantastic roles you've had, the characters you've done. Talking about Days of Our Lives for just a moment, do you have a particular standout moment, something that you love best about doing that show?
Well, I don't have a particular standout moment. I do remember, though, I was on the show for 3 years, and we just laughed. We just laughed. We just had a great time and broke some molds. There's no question about that. And I think the audience went along for the ride. And also, that's for sure as well. So, as a matter of fact, just a few minutes ago, I got a text from Arlene, who played Calliope.
Yeah.
So we're still in touch.
That's great.
Yeah.
Those lifelong friendships, too.
Yeah.
It's got to be another
right.
rewarding aspect.
Absolutely.
And doing the voiceovers, Arlene, obviously, Harlequin on Batman, you voiced several animated characters, Mr. Freeze, among others, but Discord from My Little Pony, which has a huge following. My Little Pony is amazing.
Huge following. I mean, that was completely out of the blue. They called up. They said, you have an offer to do this. I read part of the script. It was well written. It's a children's cartoon. I mean, that's all I really needed to know. And I did it, never to think about it, to be thought of again. And then all of a sudden it opened this world of bronies, which which I then went ahead and produced a documentary on.
Yeah.
Because I found it so interesting that it's right out on that skinny branch where you go, well, wait a minute now. This is a cartoon intended for, 8-year-old girls. Why are 20-year-old guys watching it? Oh, there must be something really nefarious about that. only to discover that the world is actually a lot larger than we all think. And so I was really pleased and proud about doing that documentary, because it gave a lot of people cover to enjoy something and to create a sense of community that was not what, you know, what other people were accusing them of.
Right. You know? And Discord, there's some similarities between Discord and Q, certainly.
Well, yeah. Yeah, there are similarities, but the main similarity is me. I did not know that they wanted my character to be like Q, nor did I go into it to do it like Q. Every piece of material that you read has its own kind of vibration that comes off the page. The better it is, the more that vibration is, so that you begin really sensing off the page what that character and what that story and how it's being told is. So if I had to apply it to anything, that character, any to Discord, to any other character, I would say Oscar Wilde.
Certainly, yeah.
You know, extremely flamboyant,
right.
You know, emotions out on his sleeve and stuff like that. And I've played a lot of characters like that. So in my mind, I was, nor when I play it, do I think of playing Q. I'm sort of basically playing myself. Yeah.
But you always have this joie de vivre in your characters. It seems like every character. I see you on Torchwood or an episode of Librarians. You're just kind of known for that energy, like you mentioned, the vibration. You vibrate almost at a different frequency from other people, it seems. Would you attribute that to part of your success?
I don't know. I'd never thought of it that way. I don't know. You know, we work a lot out of fear, actors do. Fear of failing. Mm-hmm. Fear of failing is enough. So that kind of gets you vibrating right there.
Right. Sure. So. With the new Picard series they're talking about, they've already talked about possibly bringing Brent Spiner on.
Yeah.
Has there been any mention at all?
No. I don't. There hasn't, nor would I expect them to, and nor do I actually think it makes much sense. I mean, I'm a immortal character who looks quite mortal 30 years after doing the first episode, and life goes on. You know, they asked me to play to go back and do Eugene again. I said no. Those times have changed. That was a very heady time when I was doing Eugene. When I was on Days of Our Lives, it was at sort of the heyday.
Yeah.
All of that is gone. It's just gone. We used to rehearse a whole day before going to tape. There's no rehearsal now. They are shooting, I think, 6 episodes in 5 days. I mean, it's just... Al Raven, the wonderful producer, he's passed away. You cannot go back and recreate. And so I'm always happy to leave before the party's over.
Sounds good.
Yeah.
And that's a great place to leave the interview, I think.
Okay.
John de Lancie, thank you so much for your time today. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you.
Fantastic interview. It's always good to get to talk to these people and find out what their thoughts are. And he's been on my list for quite a while, so I'm very glad I got to meet him here at GalaxyCon Richmond. And I hope you enjoyed our chat with all these celebrities today. We're going to come back in our final segment and wrap things up very briefly, so stand by.
This is Kevin Conroy, the voice of Batman. You're listening to Geek to Me Radio.
And you've heard our interviews earlier with Diane Pershing and John Glover. Kevin Conroy is also here making it a Batman triple threat at GalaxyCon Richmond. It's been fantastic to be here to see all these celebrities. They've got anime people. They've got comic book artists. I've already talked to John DeMattis, who was on the show about last year, I believe. Keith Giffen, who we had on from Planet Comic Con, is here. They've got, obviously, Paris Cullins and Gary Kohn. We spoke with them. Mark Wade, we'll have an interview with him in the coming weeks. I just didn't have time to get all these great interviews on the show for you today, but hopefully you are following Geek to Me Radio on Twitter and Instagram, at Geek to Me Radio. You're liking the Facebook page, facebook.com/Geek to Me Radio. And we always try to get information up there as to where we're going to be, like next weekend. We're used to being on Sundays, but we're broadcasting the next two Saturdays to go to these conventions here in GalaxyCon Richmond this Saturday. Next Saturday, broadcasting live from Superman Celebration in Metropolis, our third straight year doing that. And we will have Katrina Law from Arrow, from Spartacus. She'll be on the air with us live, we believe. We're still waiting on confirmation. I'm not sure if it'll be pre-recorded or if it'll be live. But that'll be next Saturday, June 8th, from Superman Celebration in Metropolis. Hopefully we'll see you there. Drive on out. It's a great time. It's kind of like State Fair meets Comic-Con. It's a great time at Metropolis Days. I want to thank Joey B., my executive producer, back at the station for coming in on Saturday and making everything sound as good as he does. He picked out all the return liners coming back. He did his research, knew what guests were here, and literally the show would not sound as good if it were not for Joey B. So thank you very much, Joey, for all that you do back there at the station. We've got a lot going on still. We've got interviews that I haven't had a chance to air yet. So hopefully you're subscribing on iTunes, SoundCloud, Podomatic, and you're giving us a like there. So if you missed an episode, maybe you didn't hear my last interview with John Glover, you can go on iTunes or one of the platforms where you get your podcast. You can hear it there. If you do get your podcast from iTunes, we do ask that you please give us a like, a 5-star rating or whatever it is, and a nice review. That helps boost our search visibility up on search engines like Google and Bing and things like that. We are standing right now in front of all the voice acts. They've got a bunch of Power Rangers here, too. I'm looking. They've got Karen Ashley. They've got Nakia Baris. Kel Mitchell's here from Good Burger. John Morton, who actually played Boba Fett in Empire Strikes Back. He's going to give that great line, "He's no good to me, dead." So there's something for everyone. Star Wars fandom, Star Trek fandom we mentioned. Alice Cooper is here. If you're a rock and roll person, they've got wrestlers. Sergeant Slaughter, due to contractual obligations, couldn't give us an interview. But he did give us a very nice return liner, which we'll have for you in the coming weeks. So make sure you stick around. Geek to Me Radio on Twitter and Instagram. Just at Geek to Me Radio. Follow me there. And we will always keep you apprised of all things going on in the world of pop culture. So with that said, I'm going to go get my line for my photo op. Until next week, my friends. Thank you, Richmond. Good night.